I'd like to begin by welcoming you to The Therapy Show, a podcast series that seeks to explain the leading forms of psychological therapy to the average person. We will be doing that by interviewing the professionals who develop those therapies so we can better understand when to use them and how to get the most out of therapy. Today, I'm honored to welcome Dr. Michael Nichols, who currently serves as professor of psychology at William & Mary and has been a leading researcher, teacher, and practitioner of family therapy for over 40 years. Dr. Nichols is the author of many seminal books, including The Essentials of Family Therapy, which is currently in its sixth edition. Dr. Nichols, welcome to The Therapy Show.
Good morning.
Dr. Nichols, can you start by telling us a little bit about your personal background and professional development that led you to your work in family therapy?
Sure. I earned a PhD in clinical psychology from the University of Rochester. During one's doctoral education, we were exposed to a lot of different approaches, and I was intrigued to learn a little bit about family therapy. But I realized after I obtained my PhD that to be a good therapist, I would have to seek out some advanced training. And so I spent actually several years studying family therapy with Salvador Mnuchin, one of the pioneers of family therapy. I also studied with Murray Bowen, another of the pioneers. And finally, I also went to a psychoanalytic institute to learn all that I could about the inner workings of the mind. So I got a lot of training, and then the training, the advanced training enabled me, I think, to be a better and more competent therapist. And then I felt equipped to do a good job with people.
Absolutely. How would you briefly explain family therapy to a non-professional, somebody who is new to family therapy? How would you explain it?
Well, it's a new way of thinking about human problems. It often involves meetings that include the whole family, but that is not the essence of the approach. The essence of the approach is understanding problems in context, meaning that if someone has a problem or a parent is worried about a child or even an individual is unhappy about something, a family therapist will talk with whoever wants to come for therapy, but regardless of who's present, the family therapist will think about the whole network of relationships the person's involved in. So that is the essence of what family therapy is. It's a way of thinking about problems as embedded in a complex network of human relationships.
And when and how did you realize that family therapy would be an effective form of a therapeutic intervention?
When I was a very young therapist, I saw a man who was having problems with test anxiety, and I did all the usual kinds of therapies that were in vogue back then for test anxiety, involving helping him relax and decondition his anxiety and so on and so forth. And he enjoyed therapy very much, and it didn't help him at all. And so I started talking with him, and he mentioned his wife several times, and I thought, oh, well, I wonder if there's anything there. So I invited his wife to come and join us for a session, and it turns out this man who had test anxiety was married to a woman who didn't want him to get his certification because it would involve moving out of town. So therapy then became a simple matter of having them negotiate with each other what they wanted to do about that.
Wow, that's really interesting. And who is family therapy most effective for, and why should people choose a family therapy intervention rather than another type of intervention?
Well, it's most effective with people who have relationship problems. Obviously, couples who are having trouble getting along, or parents who are having trouble with the child. But it also could be useful for anyone who's involved in one of the family life cycle transitions. In other words, a parent whose children have left home for college, say, or a man who's retired and stopped working and, you know, spending all his time at home. These life transitions often trigger problems in relationships, even if the person suffering from the problem doesn't necessarily think about that immediately. For example, a man who retires might become depressed, and a biologically minded person might think, well, he needs medication. So that's entirely possible. But in addition to that, it may be that the man who's retired is no longer getting a kind of professional satisfaction and rewards from his job, and he and his wife aren't getting along very well. And so that may be involved in the depression.
Excellent. So what's the average length of treatment for somebody working with the family therapist?
That varies quite a bit. However, let me say this, that if someone is seeing a family therapist and things aren't beginning to happen in the first two or three sessions, they may never be happening. So it may take a while, may take several sessions, 10, 15, 20, but you should see things starting to open up in the first two or three sessions. Because family therapy isn't simply a matter of family members coming in and taking turns complaining about each other. That's all that's happening. That's not going to accomplish very much.
What skills, habits, or tactics can patients and therapists adopt, either during their sessions or in between sessions, to improve the effectiveness of family therapy?
Well, the great advantage of family therapy is you have all the important players present in the treatment. The great disadvantage of family therapy is you have all the important players present in the treatment room. And in that context, it's very easy to keep blaming and criticizing others. So the most important thing that a person in family therapy can do is to make his or her complaints, talk about what's on his or her mind, but also begin to look at their own behavior, their own contributions to the situation. It doesn't mean that everyone is always to blame or at fault, but it may be that the strategies that someone is using are not effective. So let me try and say that more succinctly. You have to take a look at what you're doing and seeing what works and what doesn't work.
So what are the most common obstacles or missteps that prevent therapists and families alike from seeing the full benefits of family therapy?
Therapists who attempt to do family therapy but aren't trained, and by trained I mean who haven't learned to see patterns of interaction and structures of family organization, and who think that therapy is just a matter of letting people take turns talking, are probably not going to be very effective.
So can you share a poignant example of where family therapy had a major impact in someone's life that you were treating?
Sure. I've seen 5,000 cases. let's see.
Take your time.
Well, I had a woman once that came to see me who was having a flirtation, and she wasn't sure what to do about the flirtation. And so it seems like that's her problem, right? Mm-hmm. Her figuring out what she wants to do and deciding how to behave. And that's how it struck me at the time. But, you know, I talked to her further, and it turns out that she felt inclined to have an extramarital relationship because her marriage was so stale and stagnant. Her husband was totally uninterested in interacting with her, and he wouldn't talk to her. Didn't tell her anything. And I was quite surprised because this was a charming, lovely woman, very bright and interesting. And I thought, what a drip this husband might be. So I invited the drip husband in and talked to them both a little bit and then asked him to tell me a little bit about his work. When he started talking about his work, he got very enthusiastic. He was very involved with his career. And I said, do you talk over these things with your wife? And he said, no, not really. And I said, oh, that's interesting. And then I instructed the two of them to have a little conversation together, which we call an enactment. And I asked him to tell her about what's going on with his career. And he started talking, and she started criticizing and badgering him, and he shut up. So it wasn't just a question of whether this woman should or shouldn't have a flirtation. It wasn't just that her husband didn't talk to her. It was that when he talked to her, she wasn't very receptive, which is half of the description. The other half of the description is when she criticized him, instead of speaking up for himself, he shut up. So there was a kind of a stagnant distance between the two of them. And once I helped each one of them see their part in that dance, they each were able to change their behavior a little bit, and they started getting along quite well, and they've been married since then for about 35 years.
That's incredible. So who is family therapy not appropriate for?
Probably less appropriate for a person who is more involved with, well, let me give you a long-winded answer. Sometimes family therapy, pertinent family, can be someone other than mother and father and brother and sister and so on. It could be a work group. Or for a college student, the family or the system the person is embroiled in could be roommates and friends. When is it not appropriate to take this kind of interpersonal perspective? Usually if someone is having a problem that they sort of recognize has to do with their own personality and their own behavior, and they're not embedded in a family context. But as a family therapist myself, I might often ask other people, significant others, to attend a first session. And if they didn't seem to be involved in any way, then I might continue with the individual.
That makes sense. So what are you most excited about in mental health treatment today?
Well, I'm most discouraged about the trend to see everything as a biological problem. And, you know, if someone has anxiety, then the response, immediate response, is to try and make the anxiety go away. If someone has outbursts of anger, someone's going to try and make that go away. And we've gotten away from trying to understand why people do what they do, why they're anxious, why they're angry, why they're explosive. I'm afraid we've gotten away from looking at people in their relationship context. So that's the opposite of what you're asking me. There it is.
That's perfectly fine. I like that answer, actually. So if you had a magic wand and could improve one thing about mental health treatment today, what would that be?
I would insist that anyone who becomes a professional therapist gets some advanced training in some kind of psychological approach, whatever they choose, but that they not just come fresh out of graduate school and go right into practice.
That is really good advice. How can my audience learn more about family therapy, either online or in print?
Well, there are a number of excellent books about family therapy. Inside Family Therapy by myself, Michael Nichols, is a good one. Family Healing by Salvador Mnuchin is a good book about family therapy. Napier and Whitaker wrote a wonderful book called The Family Crucible, which describes the process of family therapy. Those are three excellent books that come to mind.
And I'm also going to put your information up on my website. Dr. Nichols, on behalf of myself, my listeners, and all of the people you have helped through your work with family therapy, I want to thank you for your contributions to mental health treatment and for taking time out of your busy schedule to help me and my audience to better understand the field of family therapy.
You're more than welcome.
I'd like to close by reminding our listeners to please subscribe, share, and review this podcast so that you, someone you love, and people around the world can gain more benefit from therapy. There is no need to suffer in silence. Get the help that you need and create the life that you want.